Now, New Yorkers are probably wondering, what's the deal with this? WNEW 99.1 FM? How can this be? Well, if you're a New Yorker, you know that the original WNEW is no longer. This WNEW, which was not around for very long, was in Washington, D.C. And they went on the air January, I think, of 2013, maybe 2012. Have to check my notes. But they had, the parent company for them had bought a Spanish radio station, and they weren't ready to open their all news operation, which was what this station was to be. So they did that, you know, sometime early November, and they just paid a service to pipe in Christmas music, stunting is what it's called, 24/7 through Christmas. And then a day or so after Christmas, they started running the history of rock and roll. And my wife, Karen, told me about this because, you know, just changing stations in the car, she'd hit on this and found it interesting and said, do you know anything about this? I said, yeah. I heard that when I was 7 years old in WRKO in Boston. And in fact, what they were playing was the 1981 version, which is the last version, and rather different from what I heard, but still the general idea was the same. So they started this on the 26th or 27th of December, and they're still building their studio, hiring people, whatever. It took them 4 weeks. They just played it over and over and over again. It was great for a month. Every time I got in the car, I could just, you know, pop, bring it right up. Great. So it got me interested, and I started researching it, and you'll find a lot about this out on the radio devotee sites on the internet, but there's a lot of disagreement about what version, and people get it confused with other histories of rock and roll that were done subsequently. But the one that I heard was this. It originated at KHJ Los Angeles, Drake Chenault channel, part of the RKO chain, which was nationwide, and it aired the weekend of February 21st through February 23rd, 48 hours, not quite consecutive. They took a break from 4 a.m. to 9 a.m. Sunday when they played religious and public affairs programming. Those were the days when the FCC cared about such things. And but that was it. Now, it only aired on KHJ that first weekend. It was the following weekend that other stations in the RKO chain got it. But they did a big buildup for it in Los Angeles. Hey, AP, Milton. I just started. Come on in. Yeah, just started. So they did a big buildup for it in the papers and all. Here's a full-page ad from Los Angeles Times from the first day, February 21st, 1969. And they started at noon. And if you tuned in at noon, possibly 12:05, because in those days, these even top 40 stations would have hourly news broadcasts, which last about 5 minutes. But this is what you heard.
The staff and management of KHJ Los Angeles take great pride in presenting
the history of rock and roll.
Come on, you air guitarists.
Georgia on my mind. Georgia, Georgia.
So they answered the question, you know, where did rock and roll come from in the very beginning? What caused it? Well, one mint julep, obviously. So it's amazing, you know, from that one event. I'll point out a couple of things about this opening. You didn't hear Rock Around the Clock, did you?
No.
Okay. That was not, as big as that song was, it was not yet de rigueur for, you know, talking about rock, the history of rock and roll, because people didn't talk about the history of rock and roll so much in 1969. And the other thing is, this countdown goes all the way back to 1952. Most rock and roll documentaries, you know, tend to start a little later, you know, with Rock Around the Clock, with Elvis, with Chuck Berry, and so on. So, you know, from the very beginning, I think he had a different take going here that has become standard, and that's one of the refreshing things about listening to the KHJ History of Rock and Roll from 1969. Now, the voice that you heard, and you're going to be hearing a lot of him, is this man, Robert W. Morgan, one of the great AM announcers, one of the great radio announcers, really, and part of KHJ's boss radio crew. KHJ pretty much ruled top 40 in Los Angeles in the mid to late 60s. But as you may know, or you may remember, AM was getting some competition, especially in the area of rock. So I think there was an impetus for AM stations to do some different things. And as ambitious as a 48-hour documentary about rock and roll sounds, such projects were not unknown in radio at the time. This is the era of NBC Monitor, which, you know, started on Friday nights and went all the way to Sunday night, a, you know, continuous feed of news, public affairs, music, and the arts, and so on. So, you know, I don't know how often people are doing things like this today, but it was not unusual at the time, and it inspired a lot of similar things in subsequent years. So let's go back to the show. Robert W. Morgan again.
Some ingredients of rock and roll sprouted in the 1950s, but others had already been a long time growing. In the beginning, there was gospel, a blend of the rhythms of Africa, church teachings, and a people's need for musical expression. From it branched the blues, then rhythm and blues, each individual, but each resembling its parent.
Heal the sick, heal the sick, heal the sick, heal that man, heal that woman, heal, Lord. Yeah, 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 yeah.
my clothes.
Sonny Boy Williamson.
Now I done fool around in Chicago. You ain't got done almost grown.
Okay, now remember, this is a top 40 radio station, and you know they're hitting you with Sonny Boy Williamson, and this is at about noon on a Friday afternoon. I like that they chose that particular song with the lyric, "Going where the weather suits my clothes," because the song from Midnight Cowboy that Harry Nilsson sang, the Fred Neil, everybody's talking, has that, "I'm going where the weather suits my clothes." And so it continues. We skip a few years to get into the 1950s here.
From these basic forms were cast the cornerstones of pace, harmony, and emotion, the foundation of a revolutionary music which became the heartbeat and anthem of the 20th century.
In the beginning, there were nothing but rocks. Then somebody invented the wheel, and things just began to roll.
Did you ever hear tinder sax swinging like a rusty axe, honking like a thorn down in a hollow log? Baby, man is rock and roll.
Got to work on my fades. Now, this being AM radio and being top 40, of course, it wouldn't be you couldn't do it without commercials. So we're going to have a word from our sponsor here. I think we're going to have a word from our sponsor. Okay. Nope. Yeah, there it is. Okay, back to our program.
In 2 minutes, as KHJ Los Angeles turns more pages in the history of rock and roll.
Get a pencil and paper. You're going to want to write down where to go. This may be members of the Johnny Mann Singers who did a lot of jingles for KHJ, including that history of rock and roll that you're going to hear over and over.
And here's a treat on pork chops.
Write it down.
The rib end cut of pork chops, media delicious, is just 59 cents a pound at Safeway, where you always save money and get blue chip stamps too.
Safeway has more.
Okay, we'll skip ahead. It's now about 3:10, and we're deep into the history of rhythm and blues, and we get one of the first interviews, and it's with one of the greatest interview subjects anybody could hope to have, Little Richard.
Otis Redding is on a march style.
Talking about Otis Redding.
And he got the, see the same thing.
and Otis. Now, about 20 minutes after this, they shifted gears and started talking about the country influence in rock. And they kind of backed into it. They were talking to Jerry Lee Lewis, Roy Orbison, and others, and then finally Sam Phillips about who else but Elvis Presley. You'll hear from Sam Phillips of Sun Records. And remember, this is February 1969. We're going to hear Elvis's Sun recordings, which were out of print at the time.
Sam Phillips, president of Sun Records, talks about the first songs he cut with Elvis Presley.
I think the real thing that made him distinctive was that he took That's All Right, Mama, and that was an old Arthur Big Boy Crudup record that had been out on Victor for many years. And I think everybody just about forgot it, but somehow or another we had tried everything else, and we were about to give up, and he came up with the idea that, he knew this particular selection, and so he gave us a very unusual rendition of it, and so I think that blended him into the so-called rhythm and blues category. Yet didn't take him away from the country.
Well, that's all right, Mama. That's all right for you. That's all right, Mama. Just any way you do, that's all right. That's all right.
Now, they go on to play, I think, five of Elvis's 10 released Sun recordings. And this is, you know, the widest exposure that those records ever received, easily. And, you know, the 68 comeback special notwithstanding, to most young listeners, Elvis is a guy who cuts a lot of ballads and, you know, makes pretty bad movies. You know, so he's probably not being taken very seriously by the teenagers in the audience, though their older brothers and their sisters might think highly of him. So from there, I'm going to go to the end of this country rock segment, which ends with Ode to Billy Joel, excuse me, Billy Joe, by Bobby Gentry. That's another song.
We mentioned the folk structure of Ode to Billy Joe, and folk music is coming up in the next section of the History of Rock and Roll, proudly presented by KHJ Los Angeles. The Everly Brothers, Elvis Presley, Jerry Lee Lewis, Johnny Cash, and Buddy Holly will be back during chart sweeps following the folk chapter. The late Woody Guthrie opens the hour with a personal folk portrait of the Depression.
The History of Rock and Roll.
Again, can't say it too often. This is Top 40 Radio.
I had a little farm. Called it heaven. Prices up and rain.
Oops. There we go.
But that was mighty thin stew. It's a dadgum thin. You can pretty near read a magazine through it. If it had been just a little bit thinner, I've always believed that stew had been just a little bit thinner. Some of our senators could have seen through it.
What Sinclair Lewis and John Steinbeck accomplished in their novels of social conscience, Woody Guthrie matched in his songs of the American everyman. Sometimes he was topical, as in Talking Dust Bowl Blues, which began our folk section. Sometimes not, as in his patriotic This Land Is Your Land. The topical protest song was born as a pinpoint in the 1930s. It fed on the political ferment of the 40s to become a spear, then was blunted by the McCarthy era of the 50s. In the early 1960s, it again emerged as a major cultural force and changed the love-struck face of popular music, injecting realism, philosophy, and psychology into pop lyrics. It was reborn in dimly lit coffee houses and folk music clubs across the country. One such seedbed was and is the Troubadour in Los Angeles. The KHJ History of Rock and Roll takes you there for some words from Joni Mitchell, one of the finest young writers in the folk field. Miss Mitchell's best-known song, Both Sides Now, is a poetic but unmisty study of love, which owes its reality and insight to the forces generated by the topical song.
I sang folk songs, traditional songs, for a very short time. Most of the songs that were in my repertoire were contemporary songs, so they'd already begun to change and began to absorb other influences other than just, you know, the traditional structure. Most of the people who are in rock now are ex-folk singers. Mama Cass, for instance, David Crosby, Stephen Stills played the folk music circuit, so all of those people brought with them their folk influences to rock and roll, which, you know, changed it to the form that we know rock and roll today, which is quite different than it was Bill Haley kind of rock and roll. It brings more more melodic, there's more melody to it than rock and roll with just the early rhythm and blues changes. And yet rhythm and blues, of course, is a form of folk music too, so, you know, I mean, it goes on forever.
To continue our show, ladies and gentlemen, the Troubadour is proud to present, for the KHJ History of Rock and Roll, Miss Joni Mitchell.
I was a little bit late coming here tonight because I was watching television. I don't watch television that often, but a really good friend of mine was on. Two really good friends of mine were on, actually, Laura Nero and Judy Collins, and Judy sang a song of mine that's making both of us fabulously wealthy.
By the way, I don't know how well you can read that. I've tried to highlight, you know, what we're hearing and what's in blue. I can't read it too well, but that's sort of what's before and what's after, just give you more of a flavor of, you know, how extensive this playlist was. Those allusions to Steinbeck and others remind me that I should mention that the script was written by Pete Johnson, who was the rock critic for the LA Times at this point. He'd been doing that for about 3 years. And one interesting thing I found out about him was that he served in Korea, not in combat. He was there, I think, around 1960. But one of his friends, while he was there, was Richard Nader, who started doing the rock and roll revival shows right around this time. So, you know, these like-minded people found each other. And I think that the 1969 is the year that the 50s revival really starts getting going. Sha Na Na is playing gigs at Columbia University. Richard Nader is becoming active. A lot of other things are going on. And I really think that the History of Rock and Roll broadcast had a serious impact on that, because it was the first time that teenagers and, you know, way preteens like myself really got to hear all of this 1950s rock and roll. So we're going to skip ahead a few hours to midnight when they started a 12-hour segment they called the Pop Chart Sweep. And this is something I find really interesting, and nobody would ever do this in a rock and roll documentary now, but they looked at, it explored all of the what we'll call pop of those years. So, you know, this is a time when, you know, Elvis and others are sharing the top 10 with things like the theme from Exodus and Dr. Zhivago. And for that matter, you know, Lawrence Welk and Perry Como and Frank Sinatra, all those people are still having hits. And, you know, they exist kind of with a bit of friction at times, but they're still, you know, very much part of the same milieu, and they have an effect on each other. So let's skip ahead to midnight, and here's the beginning of the Pop Chart Sweep.
The History of Rock and Roll.
The KHJ History of Rock and Roll looks at popular music for the next 12 hours. American pop music is one of the wellsprings of rock and roll, just as rock and roll is one of the wellsprings of present-day pop. The music is as varied as the voices of Tiny Tim, Irving Kaufman, Frank Sinatra, and Dick Clark. Their words are part of our pop time sweep, which begins in 1896, continues through 1968, and ends, figuratively, in the year 2001.
Okay, they mentioned Tiny Tim and Irving Kaufman, and here they are.
What a pleasure to be singing this with Mr. Irving Kaufman, who made this originally famous in, shall I say, 1916 with Mr. Billy Murray.
That's right. And the title was Are You From Dixie? And Tanya, how about singing along with me?
Oh, I'd love to.
Okay. Are you from Dixie? Yes, I'm from Dixie, where the fields of cotton beckon to me. I'm glad to see you, and tell me how be you, and the friends I'm longing to see. Are you from Alabama, Tennessee, or Caroline? Any place below the Mason-Dixon line. Are you from Dixie? Yes, I'm from Dixie, then I'm from Dixie too.
Okay, and around sunrise, they broke out Brenda Lee doing one of her more rockin' sides, Sweet Nothing. Sweet Nothings, Nothins. And it's 1960, The Apartment for Auntie and Tysher. And you might have heard this segue
movies
in 1960.
Have contributed many songs to pop music, among them the theme from The Apartment, a 1960 instrumental hit by Ferranti and Tysher.
And a bit later.
Nancy Sinatra had been recording prior to 1966, but had no luck until she connected with producer-writer Lee Hazlewood.
Lost my titling here. You're going to hear Lee Hazlewood's voice.
The KHJ History of Rock and Roll asked Lee Hazlewood about country music.
Country music, in its simplest form, tells a story or completes an idea. And we all love stories. I don't care how hip that anybody pretends to be. I think if you don't like stories, I enjoy, the stories for children, fairy tales. I love them. I just like stories that begin and end. I guess, I even like a movie occasionally that ends happily. And one thing about country music, it does, expresses a thought or an idea that's complete. And it doesn't leave you hanging. You know exactly where you are with country music. You can't, when you fool around those three or four chords, you can't go very far. So you better make it, you better put it all in the lyric. Because the melody's going to have to be fairly simple.
In the afternoon, they went back to the rock and roll. Hear a little bit of Shirley and Lee here.
Presents the history of rock and roll, continuing through 1956 with the five satins and some observations by Frank Zappa.
Okay, but first, a word from our sponsor.
Golden Alkaline Energizers from the Ever-Ready Powerhouse, where the power comes from.
And find a battery with power to spare. You'll find there in the powerhouse, the Ever-Ready Powerhouse. It's the why.
The way to go.
Chicken bones.
Don't tell the Board of Health. You can't make this stuff up. Here's Frank Zappa.
I heard this kind of music. I knew that it was the kind of music that I wanted to listen to. Nobody had to explain it to me that this was music designed for teenagers. You know, you just heard it and you knew that it was your music, and it didn't make any difference if it was recorded by somebody your own age or it was recorded by an older person.
Frank Zappa, leader of the Mothers of Invention.
You know, because the
again, top 40
in those days sounded very sincere, you know, and everybody was sincere, whether they were 15 or they were 60. You know, I could dig Elmore James just as much as I could dig the Five Satins and things like that, because it all sounded real to me.
Now, one of the real coups that the production team managed was they got Phil Spector to sit for an interview. Getting him to sit for anything, I think, was an achievement. But not only that, they proposed that he do a blindfold test. They would just play records for him and get his immediate reaction to them. And he loved the idea. So we're going to hear a little bit of that.
Phil Spector worked with Jerry Lieber and Mike Stoller on records by the Drifters, Benny King, and others. Jerry Lieber remembers their first contact with him.
We've gotten a call from out here, from an old associate of ours, who said he had this great kid who wrote and produced and wanted to be in New York. And then he went out on his own and had an awful lot of talent and a lot of ideas. I thought he was extremely talented. And a little bit strange.
A producer hears more than most record buyers, and Phil Spector has two of the best ears in the record business. So the KHJ History of Rock and Roll invited him to listen to several records, a blindfold test, since he didn't know what records were being played before he heard them. The session began with the Four Tops' Reach Out.
That's the sound. I love that. It sounds like somebody beating on a chair with a leather top. This is the Four Tops singing Bob Dylan, if you listen real carefully. Anywhere can be from the sun. Everything is going to the bad. Everything is, that's really what it is. It's Black Dylan. This record carefully, you notice that Motown has the same thing Volkswagen has. They have a style, and it's never really going out of style for a long time, and as long as it continues to sell, they'll go in, and the old joke about Motown is, you know, a Motown record is the same record recorded with different lyrics every 3 weeks, you know, but realistically, they're very creative, and this was really a hell of a record, and it's a drum-based sound that is very consistent. Therefore, you can build around it. That Benny had at that time. He had a way to sell a song and interpret a song, which is the whole key really to what soul music is, interpretation. I can tell the way you hang your head. hit singer anyway, yeah. But there are a lot of hit singers around who aren't making it without, because they have no direction. It's like there are a lot of great writers around who aren't making it without direction. So I think he could be a hit star, a hit singer anywhere, but I think they're giving him the direction he needs. He really sounds in many ways a lot like Marvin Gaye, but it's not important, because the material and the direction is much better than he would have if he were, let's say, on his own.
The Phil Spector.
Pardon me. Thank you, Seth. Okay, moving right along into the midnight hour. We've had 36 straight hours of this now. Gene Pitney.
Another variety of music from Memphis scored in 64. Joe Tex remembers how he began singing for the KHJ rockumentary.
I started singing, I think, when I was about 6 years old. That's as far back as I can remember. And I started singing in church. And then when I got in junior high school in Baytown, Texas, from junior high to senior high school, I sang in the chorus and taught singing in a nightclub on the weekends, Club Ebony in Houston, Texas, where I really worked my first professional job. I finished high school in 55, and I saved up a little money, so I left Texas and went to New York and appeared on the amateur show at the Apollo Theater. And I won in the first place for 4 weeks in a row.
You had the better hold on. Hold on to what you got. You had the better hold on. Hold on to what you got.
After midnight, they did a lengthy segment on the blues. This is Jimmy Reed.
Something else she was doing for me while I was sitting there on the couch. And I said, oh, baby, it ain't gonna be like that, is it? And then she just stopped and blow and said, whew. Well, Daddy, what you want me to do?
Now, as I mentioned, they took a break at 4 a.m., but from 4 a.m. to 9 a.m. Sunday morning, so here was the sign-off before the Sunday
so
morning
far,
programs began.
So far, the 40-hour mark, we've listened to the rock roots, rhythm and blues, country, folk, and pop. The 12-hour pop chart sweep led to a 12-hour rock chart sweep, followed by 2 hours of singers, and concluding with this 2 hours of blues. The history of rock and roll resumes on KHJ Los Angeles at 9 a.m. with a two-hour focus on the words and music of rock. Then onto a six-hour study of groups with special emphasis on the Rolling Stones and the Beatles.
Okay, take a shower, take a nap, go to church, come back, turn on the radio. And here's what you got, 9 a.m. Sunday morning.
The history of rock and roll.
Van Dyke Parks' version of Donovan's Colors.
Documentary begins its two-hour chapter on words and music with Van Dyke Parks. This is his musical interpretation of Donovan's Colors. Words of the best rock writers and examples of the various schools of contemporary music will be sampled during this section.
That's nice and mellow Sunday morning music. An hour later, though, it gets a little heavier. Here's Shadow Morton talking about Vanilla Fudge.
The KHJ Rockumentary continues its survey of words and music with an example of the psychedelic school. The song was originally done by the Supremes in typical Motown fashion, but Vanilla Fudge reconstructed it in a thoroughly gothic style. Producer Shadow Morton, who supervised the process, recalled his discovery of the group for the KHJ History of Rock and Roll.
You find the fudge in the back room of some club in Long Island, right? After every other producer has turned them down. And what do you find them singing? Mickey's Monkey and Come Twist With Me. Come on. What is that? What are you doing? I mean, you don't even know where you're at. You know, so you take them and you get them into the studio. And like I say, after about 3 or 4 weeks of threatening, they begin to come around. All of a sudden, you somehow accidentally, a radio station gets hold of a dub like Keep Me Hanging On, right? And the next thing, it's like the hottest thing on a station.
And now Shadow Morton also worked with Iron Butterfly around this time, and they make an appearance towards the very end of the broadcast. Wait for it.
The KHJ History of Rock and Roll moves into its conclusion, and the record which the Rockumentary staff considers the best result of 15 years' worth of music, in a moment.
Hi, everybody. This is Alan Freed again. One of the most fabulous lead singers with the group was Sonny Till with the
Orioles. I don't know why they just dropped
Many
this in, but I'm glad they did.
Great Memory Lane hit Crying in the Chapel thrilled millions.
The History of Rock and Roll.
Okay, and we'll hear the end of Crying in the Chapel here.
The History of Rock and Roll presents the same problems as any history. If you're trying to relate the history of ice cream, do you start with the invention of the crank-operated ice cream mixer, or the discovery of milk, or the moment civilization learned the relationship of ice and water? What part did vanilla and chocolate play in the process? Do you name all the existing flavors? Can you determine the social impact of ice cream, the battles lost because of long desserts, and so on? The History of Rock and Roll has occupied 48 hours of radio time. 48 hours in which to encapsulate approximately 20 years' worth of music. There have been inevitable omissions, both deliberate and accidental. Some accidents stem from the nature of early rock and roll and rhythm and blues. Their parentage was in doubt, and they were never given birth certificates, nor was any effort made to keep a written record of their childhood. But, like the ugly stepsister, this music flowered into a beauty apparent even to its scornful family. Hopefully, the beauty and the depth and variety of that beauty has shown during the past 48 hours. Hopefully, too, the KHJ history of rock and roll has offered some insights and occasionally logical organization to what is the most illogical of all entertainments, one which can create a star in weeks and forget it in a month. It's a music of instant standards which go out of fashion and memory when a new instant standard arrives tomorrow. But a few never lose the timeliness which made them hits. Fever by Little Willie John is one. Others are Love is Strange by Mickey and Sylvia. What'd I Say by Ray Charles. My Girl by The Temptations. Good Vibrations by The Beach Boys. The KHJ Rockumentary staff considered these and other songs in their choice of the best record for the KHJ History of Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. To return to the ice cream imagery, it's something like choosing the classic flavor, involving you in comparisons such as purity versus richness versus originality in the cases of vanilla, chocolate, and Neapolitan. Because of its music, because of its words, because of the way it is sung, because of its arrangement, production, total unity, and that dread word importance, we decided the Hall of Fame had to be filled with A Day in the Life by the Beatles.
Okay, and they played it all the way through. We're not going to do that. Skip ahead to the reception, which was really great. I mean, they really had a big hit on their hands with this. Warner Brothers took out this ad. Fats, Don and Phil, that's Everly Brothers, Jimi Hendrix, all on Warner's at that time, though they'd started on other labels. As I say, the following weekend it ran on all the RKO affiliates. Then it was repeated on Labor Day weekend, or at different times in the summer. This was actually earlier in WRKO in Boston. KHJ took out this ad, patting themselves on the back, showing their ratings from the winter and then the summer here. And through that whole time, from February to August, the competition was also airing. There was a show called Pop Chronicles, which was a weekly hour. It actually started a couple of weeks before KHJ's History of Rock and Roll and went through the end of the year and I think into 1970. It was quite good. It was quite different. As you'll hear, they did a lot of staging. They worked with an LA comedy group called the Credibility Gap. They were too cute by half. We're going to hear excerpts from a show that they called The Rubberization of Soul.
Let's say you were American, male and middle 20-ish, married, middle class, and short-haired. There was a time back there in high school and college back in the 50s when you had sort of freaked out on rock and roll music. Elvis and Fats and some of those people. But for the last 4 or 5 years, well, the rock stuff has been sounding pretty sour to your aging ears, and you've tuned it out on more occasions than you've tuned it in. Now you are tuning it in again for some reason or another. Maybe it's just to pass the time. Maybe it's because the sound coming out of your speaker seems different in a way. New almost. But you can't put your finger on the difference, the newness, right away. You sit there in your gasoline-powered late model wagon, hung up in a log jam of Detroit merchandise, tuning in on a fresh, strange sound. Tuning in quite unsuspectingly on the rubberization of soul.
Try to see it my way. Do I have to keep on?
Another excerpt from the same show.
You were creeping towards suburbia at dusk on a smog-choked freeway.
Long day.
In the jargon of the day is bumper to bumper, stop and go. And it's during one of those interminable stops that you flick on the car radio, ostensibly to find out if somebody has called a sig alert. It is December 1965.
The
Defense Secretary McNamara, winding up his seventh tour of Vietnam, said the decision by the Viet Cong to stand and fight expresses a determination to carry on the conflict that can lead to one conclusion. It will be a long war. Los Angeles, the McCone Commission today released...
Went from the sails, and it looks like I've got a tiger by the tail. I've got a tiger.
PM at the Olympic Auditorium, the world's greatest wrestling match will take place as KRLA's Emperor Hudson will take on Victor the Great, a 500-pound wrestling bear.
The bear hasn't got a chance.
How can you say that?
Remind you to call in, to turn down your radios before you call in, because we're on 3-second tape delay here.
Bob?
Yes.
I turned it down.
All right, go ahead.
Can't hear you too well, indeed.
Okay. Now, they did a lot of these stagings in every show, but they also did a lot of original interviews, and one of them is with a man named Tom Wilson, you know, who's been getting some overdue recognition. He, of course, was a key producer of the 1960s in rock, working with Dylan, with Zappa, with the Velvet Underground, and many Simon and Garfunkel, and many others. And here he is commenting not on one of the groups that he worked with, but the Baroque pop group, The Left Bank.
The short-lived but talented Left Bank was one of dozens of emergent American rock groups in the era of Rubber Soul. Following the trail of musical diversity blazed by Dylan and Beatles, in this instance drawing on
the Baroque influence,
the New York band produced two imaginative top 10 records in 1966. Both hits, Walk Away Renee and Pretty Ballerina, were composed by the Left Bank's keyboard specialist, Mike Brown.
Producer Tom Wilson.
And I think one of the major strong points in any good group today is their ability to generate their own material from inside. Nobody knows what to say about you or what to say about your outlook on things better than you do.
Tom Wilson's point is an important one. In 1966 alone, for example, some of the most melodic and meaningful pop songs of all time came out of the so-called rock groups.
Hot town, summer in the city, back of my neck getting dirty and gritty. Been down, isn't it a pity? Doesn't seem to be a shadow in the city. All around, people looking half dead, walking on the sidewalk harder than a match head.
Pop Chronicles also leaned more heavily on these kind of medleys than History of Rock and Roll did. Okay, so as I mentioned, that it was rebroadcast, History of Rock and Roll, that is, on Labor Day weekend, and then for the second anniversary in February of 1971, they expanded it by 2 hours to do segments on the breakup of the Beatles and Woodstock. And from there, there would not be another revision for several years, but there was a real demand for these kind of rock documentaries. So the team that did the History of Rock and Roll, among other things, they did this 12-hour special on Elvis in 1971. And a number of years later, 1977, before the 78 revision of KHJ History of Rock and Roll, CHUM in Canada got into the act, and they did something called The Evolution of Rock, 64 hours. And by this time, as you'll hear, you know, there's kind of a rock mythology firmly in place. And so the approach is a little bombastic, and at times it gets a little morbid even. One of the great things about the KHJ history is that at the time they did it, February 1969, all of these wonderful artists are still alive. Janis Joplin, Jimi Hendrix, Jim Morrison, Brian Jones, the list goes on. So they're being discussed, in some cases interviewed, as, you know, living, breathing artists who are contributing to the popular music of the day. Within a couple of years, of course, they're all gone, and other people are dying in the 1970s, and so it becomes very hard for radio to talk about them without getting all solemn. And that kind of colors our perception of them and their music. So here, let's just hear the beginning of the first hour of Evolution of Rock. Maybe see what I mean here.
One, two, 3 o'clock, four.
And of course, they start with Rock Around the Clock.
Ladies and gentlemen, the evolution of rock is about to unfold in a forceful epic of words and music. This monumental broadcast extravaganza is the most comprehensive work ever undertaken, outlining the unmatched potencies of the radio medium and the rock music industry, unparalleled by any other cultural or entertainment facet on the face of the earth. You'll learn why sales of records and music-related items have risen to top those of all other entertainment forms known to men. You will begin to understand how, since the advent of television, radio and records have catapulted to colossal proportions, outdistancing the estimates of even the most astute prognosticators. But most important of all, you will recapture for yourself the evolution of rock and roll, from its early roots in rhythm and blues to Elvis, from doo-wop to folk rock, from the Motown sound of the early 60s to Beatlemania, the British invasion, acid rock, flower power, and the fragmentation of music in the 70s. Full circle, from the roots to a full-scale revival and beyond. From the most basic to the most complex, and every variation in between. This is the evolution of rock, repeating for one immortal moment in the limitless space of time, the musical and cultural highlights of more than two historic decades. From Bobby Sachs to Blue Jeans, from the Twist to the Twilight Zone and beyond, more than 60 hours of the history that kept the world spinning. The events, the fads, and the theme of the times, underscored by the music that set the stage for the evolvement of a new generation.
One, two, three,
the evolution of rock, the fun and the fury of the most flamboyant years in the life of our planet, is now ready to be recaptured for all eternity. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the evolution of rock, the music that made the world turn round.
Now that's an introduction. Some more massive 64, some more publicity from the same issue of Billboard. As I say, they were preoccupied with artists who had died, in this case Gene Vincent, so I want to give them credit for bringing him in, you know, an artist who doesn't get enough recognition and, as you'll hear, had a rather sad end.
Gene Vincent was a Presley type. With his black leather jacket and motorcycle boots, he looked Presley. And by adding a special flutter echo to his countryish voice, Capitol Records had made him sound Presley. Bebopalula was an instant hit.
It's a sad, sad story at the end.
Fate, however, would allow the new star to go no further. There could and would be only one Elvis Presley.
He says, I'm down in the dumps, I don't have nothing, and I need a record company. I said,
Is that all you want? He said, yeah. I said, look, let me talk to Fred Foster. You can come home anyway. I'm sure there will be no problem. We'll start with that. He says, oh, my, really? Yeah, I said, give me your number. So I took the number. And I talked to Fred. He says, Lord, yeah, we'll take him right away. I said, fine. So I called Gene back. And I said, Gene, you got a contact with Mike? He says, well, he says, I've got a commitment for 90 days of shows in England, Scotland, and Sweden, the Benelux countries. The promoter there has got me booked for 3 months of shows, and I need the money, and here's an opportunity for you to make it. So then he left to go to England, and he did 3 shows and had 3 losers. So the promoter canceled the whole tour, and Gene was flat on his back again, but he couldn't overcome it. Was too much. He got to drinking real heavy. He felt sorry for himself. The promoter said, all right, I got you. I'll get you back to California. So the promoter gave him enough money to get him back to California. He went back to California, locked himself up in his room at the hotel, and drank himself to death. He had a tremendous bleeding ulcer, very, very bad. And one day he called his daddy. He says, Daddy, he says, I'm sick, come and get me. So his door was locked, and they had to get the key from downstairs. When he opened up the door, he was laying on the floor in the middle of his room, and blood was coming from his mouth. The bleeding ulcer had worked. They took him, rushed him to the hospital, and they cut him open, and it was too late. He died on the operating table. But the horrible thing, this star of rockabilly time, this man who had made such an impact in the business in the 50s and continued into the 60s, when he died and at the funeral, the only people at the graveside were mom and dad and one man that represented Capitol Records were the only people at the graveside at the funeral of Gene Vincent. And what's even worse than that, mom and dad had no money, Gene Vincent had no money, and California buried a pauper's grave.
So, as I say, there was a revision in 1978. The big change was everything that could be put into stereo was put into stereo. The format was extensively revised. It became a lot more predictable, sort of, you know, hour by hour, look at years and styles and things like that. Here's some publicity. This is actually, they've made booted it up to 52 hours. And you know, all the hours, all the segments here, and gonna zoom in on a little detail here. There's Brenda Lee with Sweet Nothings, but it's just out there as, you know, one of the hits of 60 and 61. No further context except for all of these other big hits. So, you know, you can't fault the selection of music, but yeah, something has been lost here, I think. Now, we'll just go back to the very end of the show. I may have to sneak out of, whoops. It's a day in the life. I want to skip ahead a little further. Closing pronouncements.
Produced it generally after Pete Johnson wrote it. Ellen Pellicero was production coordinator. Sandy Gibson was production assistant. And Bill Mouses was audio supervisor. This is Robert W. Morgan.
Now, Sandy Gibson, who we mentioned, did all the interviews for the History of Rock and Roll. She lives in the D.C. area. I've been in touch with her recently. And she also put me in touch with Pete Johnson, sent me his email yesterday. I haven't been able to write to him yet. She, Pete Johnson, and Ellen Pellicero are the living members of this production team. Sandy also told me that all these music beds were created for History of Rock and Roll, which is too bad because I really would like to get a record of this, you know, snappy organ treatment of a day in the life here.
KHJ Rockumentary staff extends special thanks to Phil Spector, Miss Joni Mitchell, Steve Allen, Professor Paul Tanner, Art LeBeau, Skip Taylor and Ken Heat, Harvey Siders and Leonard Feather of Downbeat Magazine, Harvey Geller of Cashbox Magazine, Charles Hefty, Dale Lowry, Tom Brower, Tony St. Clair, Shelley Gordon, Charlie Tuna, Bob Roche, Don Brown, Scotty Brink, Harvey Miller, Dexter Young, Walt Radke, Robin Hill, John Badeau, Ken Orchard, Roulette Records, Miss Christine O'Dell in London, Sebastian Stone in New York, Tom Moffat and Steve Nicolay in Honolulu, Ted Atkins in Detroit, Scott Seagraves in Memphis, Les Turpin in San Francisco, Jim Miller in Nashville, Brad Messer in Dallas, Bill Burkett in Pensacola, Watson Hodges in New Orleans, Steve Martin in Las Vegas, Paul Drew in Philadelphia. Promotional assistance and consideration furnished by the Troubadour Cafe and Leacock Pennybaker Incorporated. And, of course, we thank the artists, prime movers, and just plain folks whose words and information and music made the history of rock and roll not only possible, but necessary.
Not sure how long it goes on, so, you know, I'll take questions. Oh, here we go. Oh, false ending? I didn't put that fade in. You know, their target audience, first of all, which was quite big, and I think bigger in some ways than they realized. Yeah, teenagers, but also, you know, they did a big promotion on this, History of Rock and Roll. So they were probably getting a lot of people older than that.
The History of Rock and Roll is copyrighted by RKO General Incorporated and intended solely for the private use of our audience. Any other use without the express written consent of KHJ is prohibited.
KHJ Los Angeles.
Yeah, although compared to that 1970s evolution of rock, it's pretty mild.
Well, that's what I meant. Like,
yeah.
They think, you know, am I supposed to be a, you know, pot-smoking teenager listening to this seriously?
I don't know. I mean, I think it could have been any kind of teenager, but also people in their 20s and 30s, you know, who were the first generation of rock fans. Yeah, I mean, one of the strengths of that production team was that, you know, you had... I mean, the younger members were Sandy Gibson and Alan Pellicero. You know, but you also had people like Bill Drake and Robert W. Morgan associated with, you know, people who'd sort of, you know, seen it all, experienced it both as fans, but also as professionals. And I mean, I say that their target audience was bigger than they thought, or you know, broader than they thought, because in a conversation I had with Sandy Gibson recently, you know, I told her, you know, I listened to History of Rock and Roll when it first aired, and she goes, "How old are you?" And I said, "I was born in 1961, and you know, I was not yet 8 years old." She was like, "That's impossible. You know, you couldn't have been listening to the radio." I said, "Yeah, I had a little transistor radio. I used to listen to WRKO, which was the RKO station in Boston." And she goes like, "Really?" You know, she had no idea that like kids that young would have been tuning in. But remember, you know, you already have things like the Monkees on television, the Beatles have their own cartoon show, Sesame Street, you know, is having the Muppets doing Beatles songs and Blood, Sweat, and Tears and things like that. So, you know, there's a lot of rock and roll out there for preteens and pre-tens. So, you know, I think it's the audience was quite broad. Yeah, Terry.
Mm-hmm. My question is, what is the source for the recordings? Are these copies of the original recordings that were made for syndication? Did people record them off the air and you put them together as a composite? How was it done?
Okay, there are two sources, actually. Most of what you heard is from a copy of the complete broadcast that was deposited with the Library of Congress in 1969. I mean, they had, as I said, they did a big publicity push, and I think, I mean, we can find this slide from the very beginning here. Let's see here. Yeah, just I'll enlarge that a little bit. Yeah, copies have also been requested by Library of Congress, Lincoln Center for the Performing Arts, and UCLA. You know, so I mean, they probably had, you know, reached out, because that's good publicity to say, "Oh, we're going to the Library of Congress," you know. But yeah, you know, we received a copy of it in 1969. Now, that it was, you know, the complete, it was not what was broadcast, in that, you know, there are no commercials, no news breaks, weather reports, traffic reports, any of those, station identification, those kinds of things. The ads that you heard are from a copy that Sandy Gibson gave to the Library of Congress, that is, more recently, which that was made off the air as it was broadcast that first weekend. So it has things like the commercials in it. So those two commercials came from that source. Everything else came from the non-commercial copy that was deposited with the library in 1969. And I guess it aired on WOR-FM in New York City. Would that signal have reached Princeton at that time?
Well, yes, it would have. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
I just never recall anybody talking about even the concept of the history of rock and roll. It was all, what have they done for me lately?
Yeah.
The big thing being, of course, in 69, 70, all the flap over that Beatles record that people were playing backwards.
Right.
Slow speed and all of that sort of stuff.
Yeah. Well, you know, not everybody heard it, but a lot of people did. It was a big ratings success.
I understand. Yeah. I just find it personally interesting
that I've never heard anything. Yeah, I mean, when I mention it, some people, you know, never heard it at all at the time. Other people, you know, they haven't thought about it since then, but it's like, oh, yeah, I remember that. And I think one reason why it's well remembered is because there were several versions of it. So, you know, it got reinforced over the years. And, you know, as I say, after the first weekend, it aired on RKO affiliates, but after that, it went into syndication. And that last revision, as I said at the beginning, the 1981 version remains in syndication. You can get it for your station if you want.
I'll bet you that an awful lot of people would go out and buy the original version on CDs or download it.
Yeah.
If it were made available.
I've seen people offering them on eBay and elsewhere. You know, copies that fans made at the time, yeah. Yeah, Tim.
Rock started looking back on itself as early as 1959.
Mm-hmm.
Those were goodies.
Right.
Yeah.
The first one came out.
Art LeBeau, I didn't play it. Art LeBeau was interviewed for this.
Yeah, and it was very popular, and therefore there were lots of others, invitations, DJs, and put in the early 60s. You said there were other things on the air before this.
Oh, I don't know really of anything much before this. You know, there's Pop Chronicles, which, you know, they had the first installment on the air a couple of weeks before this happened. Prior to that, I certainly don't know of anything on this scale, you know, that was heard across the country. I'm sure, you know, you did have a lot of unusual and interesting radio by this time, you know, late at night, people, you know, spinning records and talking about things and comparing different styles and so on, you know, and there was already, you know, some oldies radio by that time. But I don't know of any histories like this before 1969. It's about this time that you start getting the first books. There's John Gabry, The World of Rock. Charlie Gillett's book is a year or two later, Sound of the City. You know, you start to get it around this time.
Yeah, late 60s.
Yeah, 68, right. Mm-hmm. Seth?
Matt, the narrator on the original broadcast, did he do that live or did they tape everything?
No, it was taped. And yeah, and in fact, when it was heard on the affiliates the following weekend, they sent out tapes and scripts, and they would have one of the staff announcers do it, so it would seem to be originating, you know, from that station. We received 16 3¾ IPS. Yeah, 3 hours per tape. Yeah, and
Did they do at least half track or was it quarter?
It's half track. Yeah. On the other hand, it was heard on AM radio. So, those two commercials though, that came from Sandy Gibson. Those are from DATS, which were made of the reels that Bones Howell, the engineer, made for her as the original program aired. So, yeah, if I you know, I grab those ads from those DATs, but you know, we haven't transferred those DATs. I mean, it'll be sonically a much better copy than.
What's interesting is that you can hear certain records that have been played quite a bit. How worn out they were.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But they must have, at a certain point, got syndicated tapes for playback.
Yeah, well, they were right there in L.A., you know, had access to a number of the labels. So, and at different times, you know, you'll hear, you know, some unreleased takes and things like that. So they had some access.
It's also amazing, too, especially with the 45s, how many of these things were off-center.
Yeah.
You can hear that pitch instability.
Yeah.
That we were so accustomed to at the time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So, Steve.
Matt, you were saying that they can still play the show.
Yeah.
What version do they still play these days?
The 1981 version.
And that has the additional material, but is that on a different format? Is that also just copies of the original 3¾?
Well, they upgraded the they redid everything in 78, and you know, anything that they could find a stereo version on, they would put that in. So everything was in stereo, and I don't know that they got access to masters, but I think they had, they generally upgraded the sound, And yeah, you don't hear much less surface noise and off-center things. And also the quality, the technical quality of the interviews is you know, much different. Well, Bill Drake of Drake Chenault actually voiced the 78 and 81 revisions. Some people were involved in it, but for instance, actually most of the people that I've talked about were no longer involved at that point. You know, Pete Johnson, Ellen Pelissero, Sandy Gibson, Ron Jacobs may still have been involved at that time, I'm not sure. But it's a pretty different show at that point, and because the music had changed. So you're getting long segments on artists like Barry Manilow, for instance. You know, it's a very, you know, it's just different. Who knows what it would be like if they tried to do it today. Yes?
Do you know how long it took them to prepare this? It's quite an undertaking with all those interviews and even hearing all that music. It seems like it must have been at least a year.
The publicity says it was a year. From what I've been able to figure out, it was somewhat less than that. They were definitely thinking about it, but I think the full-on, you know, production, the gathering of interviews, the playlisting, the you know, the tape splicing and mixing and everything, all of that seems to have been done from you know, November '68 into February of '69. Yeah, I mean the full-on. You know, the full-scale production part of it, you know, really seems to have been a, you know, an incredible effort. But really, in just 2 or 3 months' time.
The rest of this Phil Spector interview was interesting in that part that you
played. Yeah, I mean, it's just. Nothing quite like that. You know, where he's just sort of, where they're just, you know, throwing records at him and getting his first response. Yeah, you know, he was still a name, you know, he was still, I mean, he was in there pitching, so his, you know, his opinion about current records really mattered, even if he wasn't having hits himself. Yeah, actually, it's about this time, well, let's see, February 69, the Get Back / Let It Be sessions have just ended, that was January of 69. And I don't think Spector had been brought in. No, he hadn't been brought in by that time. He came in much later to you know, to prepare for release. Oh yeah, very much so. Yeah, yeah, but not a big hit maker at that point. Yeah.
Any luck in finding the original production tapes that probably look like a picket fence?
I'm sure that yeah. I'd hate to resplice those reels. Yeah. Although. One of the things, a neat aspect of the 1978 revision, and it's in the 81 revision expanded, is to finish it off, they created a, it takes about 42 minutes, 43 minutes, you can find it on YouTube, I believe. They started in November of 55 and went up to some point in 1978. It was a mashup of every number one song.
Cool.
Yeah. I mean, it's and it was all done razor blade and tape. And Carrie Janelle said he saw the guy do it. Carrie Janelle's a ARST member. Yeah, he said it was the most incredible thing you ever saw. And it really is an amazing thing to hear. Because especially when you're in the 50s and 60s, when all this classic stuff is coming out, and you're getting like 2-3 seconds of it, it's just overwhelming. And, you know, it kind of slopes off a little bit in the 70s. You know, it's not nearly as exciting, but still, it's quite an experience. And I wish I could, I can't remember this man's name now who did it, but he said that, you know, it was an idea he had, and so he put it all together, and he left it with a woman that he was working with and said, listen, tell me if you think this is any good, if we can use it. And so, you know, he left her with it there, and he went out, got lunch or whatever, came back in a half hour or so, and she was sitting there with the tape playing, with her face buried in her hands, and he's thinking, is it that bad? And then you know, she looked up, she was weeping. I mean, it was just this incredible, you know, experience to, you know, relive all of this in this way. Because some of the songs, you get like 1.6 seconds of them, but you know what they are. That's how recognizable they are. And you're getting hit, you know, in the space of 60 seconds, you might get hit with 15 or 20 of these songs. And, you know all of them. It's really incredible. Peter.
Is Alan Freed generally attributed to coining the phrase term rock and roll?
Yeah, applying it to music, yeah.
What was it called before then?
Well, rhythm and blues, yeah.
Times called race music.
Yeah, race music, yeah. I'm not sure why. They could have gone back further. You could have gone, 51, I think, was 60 Minute Man by the Dominoes, 1950. Rocket 88. I mean, it's like, it's interesting, you know, the things that are, you know, even though, you know, I guess nobody, and I'm not trying to take anything away from Rocket 88, it's one of my favorite songs, but, you know, nobody was promoting that as the first rock record. I mean, another thing you won't hear in this is Wynonie Harris, Good Rockin' Tonight, which is 1947. So, you know, there are a lot of things which either, you know, they decided not to use, or maybe they couldn't even, you know, get a record to use. That's another thing.
Did they stick with that in the later revisions? 81. Are they still claiming, you know, 1 minute
jazz? No, I don't know that they go back that far. That's a good question, and I don't know if they start that way. I mean, I like that they do that, and that, you know, you get back, you get to Elvis in 56, and then it's Chuck Berry, and then 54, 53, 52, it's all black vocal groups, you know, which, because that's what R&B was, you know, at that point. You know, and that stuff was having national impact. Nobody was, well, maybe Alan Freed was calling it rock and roll, but it was mostly rhythm and blues. You know, so you don't, you know, I like that they sort of chose that as the jumping off point. And, you know, very quickly they go to some things that are earlier than that with blues and other excerpts.
Well, Willie Mae Thornton's Hound Dog.
Yeah, that's heard elsewhere in the program, you know. I mean, they touch on a lot of bases. You know, they don't get everything. You know, there are some faults, but, you know, for when it was done, I think it's, you know, really quite an achievement. Yeah. I mean, Mike.
Yeah. This is an observation I had. I don't know. But at that time, when that documentary was done, there was also the alternative of FM, progressive, underground, rock,
yep,
etc. And yet I see here's a top 40 station applying that type of format where on FM radio you could hear on those stations someone playing an Elmore song, and then it evolved into maybe the Allman Brothers doing Done Somebody Wrong, etc. Did anyone notice that at that point? Because supposedly there was such a divide between AM commercial radio and the FM free form.
I don't think that... I don't think these things were you know, quite set in stone yet. When KHJ introduced, you know, the Boss radio format about 3 years earlier, I think it was, you know, that was like really a shot in the arm to Top 40. You know, instead of just, you know, emphasizing this tight playlist, you know, they brought in all of these jocks who had like great personalities, and you know, they just introduced this, you know, incredible pacing, but also all of this humor and off the wall stuff. I mean, one of the great, when Carrie Janelle did his KHJ panel a few years ago in Los Angeles, you know, they relived some of the promotions that KHJ did. There was a character they had called the Big Kahuna, who was this supposedly this you know, Robinson Crusoe type guy who like floated in on a raft, you know, to the coast of California, you know, and you know, they put him on the air, you know, so they were doing a lot of really unusual things, and of course, top 40 at that time had to make room for things like, you know, Cream, which you'd heard, and Hendrix, and you know, the psychedelic bands and so on. So there were a lot of unusual things on top 40 radio at that time. And you know, and yeah, I think they recognized that FM, you know, was nipping at their heels, even if every major market in the country didn't have a progressive FM station yet. It was happening. Although an interesting thing, the first progressive station where I'm from in Boston was WBCN, and almost from the beginning, they had a 1950s rock and roll show hosted by a guy named Little Walter, who is still doing 50s music in New England. So they, you know, they found, yeah, I mean, you know, they didn't see that, you know, as a, you know, a stretch. You know, they were.
They claimed the first FM progressive was WOR FM,
yeah,
due to a strike.
Mm-hmm.
Jock, so they just started playing album cuts.
Yeah.
Ironically, WOR.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, I think there was a lot of back and forth at that point. And as I say, you know, there were more of these shows produced in the 70s and into the 80s. You know, I can remember WRKO, you know, doing whole weekends of different things, or like, you know, I remember a lengthy thing, the history of the Beach Boys, that was done at one point. So, you know, it's just good to remember that all of these things, it's not so cut and dried, you know, that they did more than you might think.
It's amazing what was, you know, under the umbrella of rock and roll, like in the early 60s, those playlists I gave you.
Mm-hmm. Well, or all pop music, you know. It was all, you know, you could have these things kind of side by side. That wasn't, you know, of course, you know, and this is the other thing to remember. Most cities of any size had more than one top 40 station. So, you know, if Marty Robbins El Paso came on and you're out driving, like, oh, not this one, you know, you you switch to the other station. But, you know, it was all happening at the same time. Yeah.
So
mm-hmm.
It can be
negotiable. Yeah. I mean, I once, do you know this band, The Skeletons? They're out of Missouri, I think. Yeah, they used to do a theme from A Summer Place as part of their set. Really nicely on the harmonica. Yeah. So, Steve. Mm-hmm.
But you could never get a radio station to play this colorful mix of music.
Right, right.
Everything is so unbelievably fragmented.
Thanks to those two bastards in Los Angeles who, quote unquote, streamlined and cheapened broadcasting to get rid of the high cost of paying for quality DJs. Mm-hmm. When each one of those obituaries appeared in the Times, I went right down to the pub below my office and had a martini to celebrate.
Who were they?
Were you thinking of Drake Chenault?
I can't remember.
Because it was Drake Chenault that produced this.
Now, these people, the least amount of commentary possible.
Okay.
Innovation need not apply. Theme radio was anathema. There were two of these characters out
mm-hmm.
of Los Angeles who were working together.
What year are you talking about?
In the late 60s, early 70s. I'm sure if you did some research, forgive me, I'm tired.
That's all right.
But you'll find these two
mm-hmm.
schmucks, for lack of a better expression. I have better expressions, but they're impolite.
It's prime time right now.
Yes.
Mike?
Also, perhaps the show couldn't be done in the fact that now everything has to be a hit that anyone can identify with. And I've heard that the aspect is with kids, any music beyond 5 years past
mm-hmm.
is ancient history. So I see a lot of college students.
students wearing a t-shirt that says The Beatles. Is this a band that snuck under the radar that I'm not aware of?
So well,
I'm wondering if that's another reason, too. No one wants a sense of history because we live in a very predisposable culture, MTV and the soundbite mentality, and then it's there and gone.
Yeah, yet it's easier to find, you know, if you know what you're looking for, it's easier to get it than it's ever been. I think that well, it's unfortunate, but like oldies radio has become incredibly tightly playlisted. You know, you have artists who had like 10 or 15 hits, you know, yet only one of their songs will get played because that's the one the focus groups responded to. Mm-hmm. So,
okay. It's not my experience of young people. I'm a psychotherapist. I see a lot of young people. That's not really the case at all. It's very, very varied. There are so many who know the music of our era better than they know the music of today.
Oh, I'm amazed by some of the...
in college radio stations, sir. I'm just saying that I think that this bleak picture that's being painted and that this poor...
As I say,
we weren't listening to music for
college
years.
Radio station.
I hear you. I was in college, and you know, we weren't playing music of the 19th.
Yeah, I mean, I'm surprised by, you know, some of the things that, you know, these young people of today actually know about and seek out. But yeah, how many are in college radio or any other kind of radio? I don't know. I don't, you know, I know that I don't find a whole lot to listen to on the radio of that sort. You know, as for the Beatles, it's a facet of the Beatles that, you know, they have enduring popularity. Not just that, you know, somebody my age or older still likes them, you know, and I can remember when they were still a group, but I worked in a record store in the 80s and I worked at a record store again in the 90s. And kids who were 12 and 13 at that point were buying Beatles records. And, you know, I think the same still holds true today. You know, that's, you know, a really remarkable thing about them is they continue to appeal to young people who get to hear them. Yeah, I mean that's Sinatra is another artist who, you know, still gets through. So, shall we
Yeah, I think we can. Any other questions?
Thank you.